March of last year, so we're almost, March of 2015, so we're almost 2 years old. I'm Elizabeth, I am from Branch. I would like you all to give yourself a round of applause for making it here tonight and waiting for that pizza. Come on here, let's have some fun. All right, so I run community and events at Branch, which is mostly the global growth community and then a bunch of the conferences and things that we speak at. I've been with Branch for about 2 years, and have been building the mobile growth community pretty much my entire time that I was there. So you are actually part of a worldwide community of over 50 groups, over 20,000 people across the world who are facing the same challenges that you guys are, which are, how do you build a business on mobile? How do you get users? How do you keep your users? And how do you make money out of that? So we throw events like this about 8 to 10 times a month across the globe. So in fact, tomorrow I will be rushing back to San Francisco so that we can do our meetup there. Vancouver is one of the groups that is close to my heart because it was one of the first ones that I was involved in and got to start. And I met a lot of you. But for how many of you is this your very first mobile growth meetup? All right, so next time there will be much fewer hands, right? Because they're all going to come back. Cool. So we do a thing at our meetups where if you tweet with the hashtag mobile growth, we have people back in the office in Palo Alto who are paying attention to the Twitter sphere, and they're gonna pick the best tweet of the night, which is usually the one that Cynthia likes the best. And then you can win a Branch hoodie. So this is Evidence. This is one of our winners. She comes to our meetups in San Francisco a lot, and in fact, her friend like saw her in the slideshow and was like, you're famous! And I'm like, not quite, but okay. So, before we go any further, I want to say thank you to Codeform for hosting us. This is the first time that we've been in their space. I know they've hosted a lot of really great events here. And so let's give them a round of applause for opening the doors up to us. If you guys have any questions about Codeform, feel free to talk to Luke back there. So Luke's going to wave. He's one of the guys in the flail. Might be hard to pick up. There's a lot of guys in the flail here. So. All right, so our other sponsor is a company called Grow.co. How many of you are familiar with Grow? All right, so we have a couple hands. So Grow is a company that is focused mostly on growth marketing, mostly for mobile. My favorite part about them is that they run a series of conferences that are really great, the best one being Mobile Apps Unlocked, which happens every May in Las Vegas. And you'll actually get an email with me with an invite to a thing that we call our Expert Hub, where you can enter to win in 2 free tickets to go to Mobile Apps Unlocked. And if you don't know who they are, you'll start to know who they are because you will get their newsletter. I promise you can unsubscribe. But I also promise that you probably won't want to. I get like literally 200 emails a day. And this is like my Wednesday morning joy when I get to go and like look at my grow.co newsletter and get a really good article and find out something really insightful that maybe I didn't think about before. But I'm from Branch. How many of you guys know what Branch is? All right, so again, next time, everyone's gonna raise their hand, right? So Branch is a startup from Palo Alto. We were founded about 2.5 years ago by four mobile app developers. They actually had an app. It was called Kindred Photo Books. It still exists. You can still find it. But we don't own it anymore, because what happened was they got featured in the App Store, and of course saw tons of downloads come from that. Lots of new users, lots of great growth. And then when that feature went away, so did all of the people streaming into the app. And they were looking for a way to solve this problem. And so they built one of the first features in the branch, which is a referral program that passes information through the app install process. Say that 5 times fast. And so they built this feature where they could get information and figure out from the referrals that they were sending out to their Midwestern moms who were like super stoked about printing photo books. Were those referrals actually converting? Was it worth it for them to put the money in there? And what they found was none of their friends in the Bay Area or the folks that they talked about really cared as much about that, you know, photo book app, but they really wanted that piece of code that would help them pass information through the App Store process with this link that they could track. So they're like, okay, we're gonna go ahead and scrap this whole photo book thing and move into deep linking, which is what is the infrastructure that Branch has built. So you guys are here, so you probably are not surprised at all by this slide, which shows that people are on their phones more and more and more. And there's a lot of opportunity for eyeballs and dollars when you get people on your apps. But it's very hard to break into apps. I think we did a study one time that showed that, you know, the top 1% of apps, which is basically Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, controls like 98% of the App Store traffic. So breaking into the App Stores and getting found and getting discovered when you have an app is a huge problem. But people are spending more time on their phones. We actually took Facebook and Twitter out of these numbers so we wouldn't skew it too heavily. So like people living on their phones, which I'm sure you've experienced, like walking and someone just staring at a phone. But people are spending a lot of time in apps, and more time than they are on the mobile web. In fact, that's because apps convert better. People like to be in apps more. It's a better experience, usually, than the mobile web. The problem is that getting people into your app is a broken experience. And that's because it was really easy on desktop. So here are all these different channels that you could share one link out that's gonna drive you back to the same exact place, no matter where you share it. So you can put it on Twitter, you're still gonna go back to see this house. You can send it out in an email blast, you're still gonna go back to this property, no matter where you're coming from. And so it's really, really easy. And on the marketer and app side, you have context for where people are coming from, and you get attribution. So you know, maybe I shouldn't spend $50 on Facebook ads because no one clicks on them. Maybe I should put my money into some other kind of channel that converts. And it doesn't work that way on apps. So apps are like walled gardens. They don't use the same sort of standard linking scheme. And so you would have to come up, it's pretty much impossible before Branch to really share out any of these links, whether you're sharing them from the app or you're clicking on them from Twitter or from an email, and get back into that app experience. But as you saw from the previous slide, you really want people to go into apps, so what do? We fixed it. So we made it so that you can use one link on all your marketing channels in all of your marketing efforts, whether it's desktop, iOS, Android, or mobile web, and you're always going to get back to the same place. Your user is going to have a better experience. But more importantly, you know where to spend your money, and you know what's driving results. You can see, yes, this person clicked on this link, and they installed my app, and I'm going to put more money in that channel. It was successful for me. So we have a lot of really awesome partners, including some of the folks that are going to be on the panel tonight. This is just a small smattering of them. Here are even more of them. And I'm going to tell you about three brands that used Branch to drive mobile growth in 2016. So the first one is Pinterest. Have you guys ever heard of Pinterest? Anybody familiar with Pinterest? Maybe one or two of you? Okay. So Pinterest just introduced this new cool thing called showcases that puts a brand, a spotlight on brands, and makes it so that they can control their own stories. So what they did was they put a Branch link in all of their search. So everywhere that they have a search ad, they have a Branch link behind it so that you'll actually drive people into the mobile app. So what happens in this example is someone's like, I want a burger and Coke because you make way more money than I do. and I'm going to search for it on Google. So they find it, they land on this ad, or they land on this this article, and it takes them to the Pinterest website. And the first thing that they see is this pop-up that's powered by Branch that says, hey, don't you want to be in our app? You're going to have such a better time in our app. And once they click on that link, if they have the app installed, they're going to go straight to that Burberry coat that they originally searched for. And if they don't have the link, we'll figure out where do you need to go, what app store, send you there, get you to install it. Once you install that app and open it again, you're going to go right back to that Burberry coat. So much better experience for the users, and Pinterest gets a lot of data around it. Another one is Goat. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Goat in Vancouver. They're a local app in Los Angeles. Any sneakerheads in the house? No? All right, so if you like sneakers, you should check out Goat. It's a really cool sharing app. They sell like awesome sneakers. They don't pay me to say it. I just really like shoes. And so what they did was they took advantage of their user base by putting deep links behind their social sharing. So they saw a 48% increase in installs from Twitter and from Instagram by using deep links. So someone would share a picture, or they would share something in their own stream, and that person would get a preview of what they're going to see in the app called a deep view. And then when they open the app, they would go straight to that pair of shoes, or if they downloaded it and opened it again, back to the pair of shoes. And then you buy the pair of shoes, and Goat is happy. All right, so Jet is the last one that I'm going to talk about. So Jet got acquired by Walmart about 5 or 6 months ago. They have been a longtime partner of Branch. We love them very much. They do a lot of really interesting growth experiments. They have a really interesting team. So I highly encourage you to check out their team if you want to learn from some mobile growth experts. But they're using what we call a Journey Smart Banner. So a Journey Smart Banner is basically one of these banners, like you've probably seen them on the mobile phone before when you're looking around, that is prompting someone to open something in the app. So this is going to help somebody search for coffee on the Jet website, or Jet and Coffee. They went to the website, there was a banner right there that said, hey, open this in the app, because they were able to detect, hey, you have the app, so we're just going to have you open it. It's a fully customizable banner that works on Android or iOS. And once they, so this person in this example didn't have the app, we took them to the app store, figured out where they need to go. And then once they open the app, they're looking at that same piece of coffee. And sometimes Jet does some really cool things where they incentivize their new users, and they say the first three purchases, we're gonna give you 15% off. And because they're using Branch deep links, they're able to actually carry that discount through the install process. So when that opens the first time, that discount is still there, and they still know that, hey, you get 15% off. So user, happy, 15% off. And Jet, happy, because they can measure that experience. Okay, they saw a really good increase in daily downloads and in app engagement. So just by using deep links to drive people into the mobile app, they're able to get a lot better results. And four more examples like that on our blog, if you want to check them out. I'm pretty sure it's Airbnb, House Party, Instacart, and another one that I'm probably gonna get in trouble for forgetting. Don't tell anyone. I'm not taking it too much. All right. So that is the end of my spiel about Branch. Thank you for listening to me. We're going to get to the content that you're really here for, which is listening to our great panel. So I'd like to invite Roshana, Lara, Kevin, and Catherine to come and join me. Let's give them a round of applause. If you could tell me, what is an app that you use on a regular basis, and that's not Facebook or Twitter, and what makes it sticky for you? Why do you keep going back to that app?
I can just choose one.
You can choose one.
Okay. In terms of daily active usage, I'd say Slack. Slack's been pretty revolutionary for us. It's pretty much the common thread that binds us all together. We have a distributed team, Vancouver, Germany. People travel, etc. We're pretty much set up that everything can work for regardless of where they're distributed, and Slack is the thread that keeps us all together.
Awesome.
Stole my thunder. Our office just moved towards Slack as well, so I highly recommend it. It's a really slick user interface. Really easy to integrate with other apps that you already have on your phone. But one app that I'm constantly checking, it looks great on tablets as well, is App Annie. It's an app store monitoring app, and it's one of very few that actually has an application. A lot of these services, such as Sensor Tower and Mobile Action, do have mobile websites, but it's probably the only one that has an app that's really usable, and it's great to just visualize how your rankings are going, the keywords in the different countries, and how you're charting.
So I don't want to say Slack as well, but we definitely benefit from number one. I have to say we use Trello a lot in our office, and it's very helpful for members who can be working in partners, people who are traveling, and do partners, so it's one of the easy ways.
All right, so we've got big Slack fans and Trello, so we're all about productivity, apparently, with this group. Lars, are you going to continue the trend?
No.
Yeah.
I'll rock the boat a little bit. I noticed you said no Facebook or Twitter, but I'll go down the social side. I'm a big fan of Snapchat, actually. It's really interesting to play with, of course, to see what friends are up to and things like that, share stories that we're doing, but two things I like is their lack of adoption of standard paradigms, just making new user interface experiences that a lot of people have now become standardized on, and also just the whole stories paradigm. I love building a nice story. It's a nice way to take someone through a chronological path that you couldn't do in other apps before, so I have a lot of fun with that.
I think I'll learn how to use Snapchat better. I think that's my problem. All right, now something maybe a little bit harder. Lars, we'll start with you since we have the mic. Can you tell me what does a typical day-to-day experience look like for you? Where you focus on your efforts? What do you work on?
Cool. So as it says, I'm a product manager at Hootsuite, and so I spend like just roughly 50% of my time on strategic stuff and 50% of my time on tactical stuff. On the strategic side, I'm spending a lot of time talking to our customers, looking at our competitors, looking at the market, looking at trends, seeing what partners we can work with if we rely on a lot of third parties and their APIs, so work with them really closely, and trying to think a few months and a few years out where we want to be. But then on the tactical side, where I really spend my day-to-day, is working with our iOS and Android teams, and our designers, working with our sprints. We do everything on a two-week sprint cycle. So we're either executing on something that we're about to deliver or planning for the next piece, and that's really where I spend all my time.
So you're not busy at all then?
A little bit.
For me, it would probably be, definitely a very collaborative approach here. So I work in the marketing department and that's growing marketing. So up until now I've been mostly social and moving a little bit into email marketing growth as well. But basically our goal is to get more app downloads and we work a lot with our B2B partners as well. So we're constantly working on different projects to try to engage their users as well. So it's sometimes it'll be dependent on what's going on that day, so it's hard to say what we have a typical day, but definitely somewhere in that realm.
So I work in mobile user acquisition for Eastside Games. I'm primarily looking at the return that we get from the users we acquire. We're looking back 3 days, 5 days, 7 days to really validate the quality of our installs. And we have some internal tools we use to do that, but I'm primarily in Facebook, using Instagram as well for acquisition, as well as Apple Search Ads, Google UAC Ads, and third parties. We're venturing into Twitter a bit more and also looking at some other ad networks to try and acquire users. So my day-to-day is basically looking at the return on advertising spend for all of our budgets. I'm also working with the art department, coming up with really cool creatives, working with our engineering team to develop new tools internally, and also kind of measuring and looking at other opportunities such as influencers on YouTube and things like that.
I'm gonna shamelessly plug Kevin right now. Don't you also run some classes, or don't you teach something about how to let other people know about your skills?
Yeah, I also, I actually see one of my students here. I teach a couple boot camps at SFU, as well as some email marketing and user acquisition classes. So if you guys are interested, there's a continuing studies program, and I'm teaching there as well.
Thanks. He didn't ask me to say that. I just really think he's doing cool stuff.
So ironically, Slack still monopolizes most of my daily active usage, but I'm trying to wean myself off of what I call Slack crack, which is basically being on Slack all day long. Like if you get a pop-up that somebody's speaking to you, like responding right away. So as the founder of a relatively new startup, When I first started, so my background is product management. That's been my career up until I started Control about 3 years ago. And as a founder, you're basically doing everything. I was doing product management, I was hiring people, I was setting up payroll, and Slack was kind of the communication channel to facilitate building the company from the ground up. Now I've got hired a few good people. I've been able to delegate a lot of those responsibilities. And now I'm trying to get away from Slack, and I'm raising a Series A, for example, this year, so I'm in Excel a lot. Excel is still one of the best simple accounting softwares that has ever been invented, and nobody's been able to really compete with it. So I'm doing financial modeling and scenario analysis in Excel. And then as we start onboarding people and pitching to investors, pitching to potential staff, I'm constantly spinning up new decks and presentations and vision decks of the company and the product roadmap in Keynote. That's my number two favorite tool.
Awesome. So aside from Slack, and this is for everybody after meeting with Catherine, what are some of the tools that your teams are using on a regular basis, and how do you make the decision whether to use a third-party tool or to build something in-house?
That's a good question. So from the top to the bottom of the stack, so we've got our marketing tools such as Intercom and MailChimp. We've got WordPress for all of our content management system. On the development side, they've obviously, you know, we use project management or Jira for our project management tool. We're using GitLab. We have an in-house version of GitLab that we host ourselves, so we have control and ownership of the source code. The development team has a variety of different tools that they use, such as log entries and various monitoring tools. In terms of what we build in-house, at this point, you know, our product is the core thing that we really focus on building in-house, and any of our, we don't have spare product development resources, so we try to use third-party SaaS tools as much as possible. We use SaaS tools because we build SaaS, because we believe that people shouldn't be building payment analytics themselves. It's a distraction from their core business. So we're very happy to deflect a lot of that the time and development resource to a affordable third-party SaaS solution.
I think that's a great point. Like if it's, and I'm sure you guys will touch on this, if it's not something that you have to build, don't build it. Somebody already did it, and they probably did it a little bit better than you will, because that's all they do.
Yeah.
And what about if you say it? You mentioned that you guys had some in-house tools.
Yeah, we have a pretty solid engineering team in-house that develops a lot of tools. Most of the time when we need to share our financial information, that's when we look at trying to create a solution internally. But day-to-day, we're working a lot with our attribution partner, which is Coachaba. That really changes the game for us as far as measuring, tracking, and validating installs. One of the cool things that they do is let you create what's called a smart link, which is similar to what Branch does, but you can share it on social media and you can track where that source is coming from, so you know what kind of campaigns you're running, no matter where they are, whether it's a blog post, you know, working with a YouTube influencer, putting a link in the description. We're able to then track and validate that in our back end and measure the return. So I'd say the attribution companies are probably are, you know, one of the largest third parties that we work with, but we're always looking at other partners when that time arises.
Fun fact, you can send all of your Branch data to Coachaba and like look at it in one dashboard, which is pretty cool. So we'll talk with her, Kevin.
For our product, so a little bit about it, it's called PressReader, and we have 6,000 plus newspapers and magazines that come on the platform every day. So we try and build as much that we can in-house just because it's such a complicated product. But in terms of marketing resources, we use MailChimp, we use Unbounce. We're always looking at analytics on social, Parsons Slack, Retello.
Cool. Of course, we use like a ton of tools across the company, but some of the stuff I'm in every day, Localytics for mobile app analytics. There's a ton of companies out there that do a good job there. We've been using them, and they've been great. We use Urban Airship for push notifications. We use Twilio to SMS links to users. We use Branch to do a customized onboarding experience. We don't have, it's not a white labeled app, it's a normal app, but our companies can send out emails like a branded Starbucks email, whatever. They might be emailing their employees, click on the Branch link, and as soon as they launch the app gets rebranded to Starbucks. So it gives them like a bit of that white label experience. Using that a lot. And then on the in-house tools side, one of the main things we have that I like a lot is this thing we've been called dark launching. It's basically like a remote ability to turn features on and off. And so we'll couple that with Localytics. And so we can run some A/B tests and It's a little ad hoc and a little baked in-house, but works really well. And it's also saved our bacon a few times when we ship stuff that doesn't work well. I just turn it right back off. So I'm a huge fan of that.
Awesome. Okay, so we talked about what you guys use, what you do. Let's talk about something that you have actually done. So if you guys can each tell a story of a growth feature or campaign that you ran that was wildly successful, or perhaps more interestingly for y'all, something that failed miserably, so that they know not to do that.
All right. I got one that's, it's definitely not sexy, but it really made a big, significant, noticeable impact. A lot of the stuff we do is like these little bumps along the way. A couple years ago, we integrated with Instagram. That made a big impact, and we knew it would because Instagram was just exploding in popularity at the time. A lot of customers were asking for it. But a subtler one that made it even like noticeable impact was just the way that we ask users for reviews. We used to have one of those really annoying things that just pop up randomly after so many launches. And we started getting one-star reviews just saying, I hate the review system, love the app, I just like stop bothering me. So we turned that off right away and came up with a solution, which was effectively, after the user has several positive experiences, so in our case, they sent messages successfully a certain amount of times, and we're adjusting the amount of times that they sent successfully, but we know that they just had a good experience. They're in a good mood right now. That's what we ask them, and we don't send them right to the App Store. We say, you having a good time, a bad time, if they're having a bad time. We offer all sorts of support, like reach out to us, email us, submit a feature request. But if they're having a good time, then we take them down the path of, hey, well, thank you, we're happy you're happy, please leave a rating on the App Store. And that made such a difference. It's remarkable. All these apps kind of nag us about that stuff, so it's kind of like a necessary evil a little bit. But we found a really unobtrusive, like simple way to do it, catches them in a good, happy spot. It drove up not only our average reviews, but also just like the frequency of reviews, the volume of reviews. So we're always like tweaking that a little bit, and Apple's got some stuff coming out to make that even easier for people to leave reviews, but that, beyond so many of the sexy features I was excited about, made such a difference.
No more one-star reviews. That is a blessing, right?
For us, you did an interesting comparison. When we first launched our app with Samsung, we had it pre-installed. And over the course of about 2 years, we had about 30 million installs. And when the first half, we thought, wow, this is amazing. We have massive spectrums. But that's actually not what happened. That conversion was really low. The quality of users wasn't ideal because they didn't install the app. They weren't necessarily interested in those papers that they needed. So that was a lesson learned for us. And then moving forward, we tried to do small campaigns that are focused on topics or interests or events that are happening. So for instance, we did one with fashion, where we just sent out an email to all of our users who had shown interest in fashion or downloaded fashion content. And just a reminder that fashion is happening. Here's our catalog of content. And we saw a massive spike. We sent a push notification as well to people in those areas and saw a huge spike as well. So these small, concentrated campaigns for us are our secret sauce, I guess, basically, whereas where we got with Samsung that we had this huge conversion, that's not what ended up happening.
One of the campaigns we ran recently was a big success for us. We're able to access something called Facebook Analytics, which is basically like Facebook Insights, but it's for apps. So one of the cool features of that is it shows other relevant pages that your fans like. So we wanted to reach out to an influencer that was relevant to our game. If you guys aren't aware, our studio makes a game called Pot Farm, which is a marijuana farming game. So a pretty unique audience that we get to work with. And when we looked at our data, we saw that a lot of our fans liked hip-hop artists like Wiz Khalifa, Eminem, and these kind of guys. So we looked at, you know, how could we work with them to get a post on their Facebook page that would direct traffic through smart links that we could attribute. And when we looked at the pages for these large brands, they obviously have a marketing engine behind it, but one little cool hack you can do with the Facebook page to really measure the engagement rate is click on the likes button when you visit a page, and it shows how many people like the page, but it also shows how many people are talking about that page. And when we looked at Wiz Khalifa, they had something like 35 million likes, but there's less than 500,000 people talking about that page. So we scrolled down a bit, and we found this blog called Herb, which is a large weed blog, basically. It's got about 7 million fans on Facebook, but there's over 1.5 million fans talking about that page. So we actually worked with a local company called Quietly to generate some content on this blog. The blog post was called How a Video Game Created the World's Largest Cannabis Community. And it talked about our studio, about the artwork we've developed, about the fact we had a Facebook cannabis game that now has moved to mobile. And within this blog post were many trackable links that directed people to iOS or Android, depending on what you're reading on your phone. By tracking the revenue we generated from these installs, we realized this was a very successful campaign. It was also substantially lower cost than working with one of these larger brands that tout we have 40 million fans. So doing that little investigation into the engagement rate really helped us, and it actually wound up making her the most relevant page in our Facebook analytics after that campaign ran. So, cool little hack there.
That is a cool little hack, and I'm going to use it the next time I meet an influencer.
So I'm going to talk about a campaign that we can't necessarily take credit for, but it's still a good tale, and it was very surprising nonetheless. So, you know, we have a web-based product. We also, this company is called Control Mobile. So it started as a mobile-first company. It started with an Android app and an iOS app. And we do all the typical stuff to try to optimize for installs. So we're constantly experimenting with different creatives and content and messaging on Facebook for app installs. We constantly have Google AdWords running to try to drive universal app installs. Now we're experimenting with Apple Search Ads, using Branch to solve what I call the attribution black hole. Has been really key for us for seeing, you know, people that come to our website or clicking links to download, we actually can see where that traffic is coming from, which was a complete mystery to us before we started using Branch. So, you know, I've used many of the tools the guys mentioned, such as Sensor Tower, App Figures, App Annie. I try to exploit them all for their free versions, and they all kind of give a combination of what I need without paying for it. So, you know, I'm constantly monitoring. We had a pretty good hum, a constant hum of what we could expect for daily downloads. And one day, our downloads just went off the roof, like 10 times, like 1,000% what our usual sort of median is. And I started digging around, and I was like, did we actually like increase the budget on Facebook like tenfold? Like, where is this coming from? And it really demonstrated the power of these traditional offline channels. So what had happened was the night previously, CBS had run, 60 Minutes had run a program on the rise of fintech or something, and they featured the two founders of one of our main partners, Stripe. So John and Patrick Collison were featured on CBS. And that just caused this massive spike that was completely unanticipated and a great surprise. It totally lifted our install numbers, but it still shows, like, here we are struggling away, trying to do every conceivable type of acquisition through all these new modern innovative tools, and TV still to this date has been the biggest acquisition tool. It's kind of ironic.
It is kind of ironic. A mobile first company that got their biggest boost from just a regular old CBS show. That's pretty awesome. Okay, so I know we mentioned a little bit about the quality of users. And Kevin, you mentioned that I made it with Brooksana. And so I have two questions about new users and acquisition. So the first one is, new user acquisition, existing user retention are things that you have to balance, and it can be kind of hard to decide where you're gonna put your efforts. So my question is, one, how do you decide that? And my second question, which I didn't give them, so I'm just putting them on the spot here, is when you're looking at users, are there any users that you don't want? And how do you figure out that you don't want those users so that you don't spend money trying to acquire them and then they just aren't, they don't stay there?
Yeah, so in terms of delineating the activities between acquisition and retention, so we kind of see acquisition as that whole series of events through the funnel. So, you know, the top of funnel, the awareness, you know, getting them, educating them about the product, whether it be through signing up for a free trial or reading content or going through a knowledge base, finally, you know, creating an account, and then our ultimate conversion event is if they convert from free trial to a paid customer. So, you know, the way the team separated is that's our marketing, that is, you know, the marketing activities and everything around that. From content marketing to analytics to attribution, et cetera. Once we have that customer, so we're a B2B, so once somebody's actually given over their credit card and they've subscribed to the mobile app, you're in a subscription mode, they are golden, and that is given to another team, our customer success team, that, you know, does everything possible to retain that customer. We set a pretty high bar for the monthly retention. I make a commitment to my board of directors every year at the beginning of the year. We're going to retain on minimum 96% of our customers every month for month. So we make a pretty clear delineation between those two activities. In terms of customers we don't want, so we're pretty lucky. We're very similar to the Hootsuite model in that we have this vetting process that happens naturally, and that people have to be. So we're integrated with Stripe and PayPal. Those are our two main partners right now. We're just in work integrating Square. We're looking at Google Play, Google Pay, Apple Pay, iTunes and App Subscription Billing, Authorize.net, and a variety of other different payment platforms we're going to be partnering with. But, you know, we have this natural vetting process in that in order for someone to use our analytics product, they already have to have a Stripe account or a PayPal account. And in order to get a Stripe or PayPal account, you have to have a business. You have to be some sort of legitimate entity. So they already provide that pre-vetting for us. So, you know, if people, we're acquiring, you know, a lot of people top of funnel, but they don't connect their Stripe or PayPal account, their PayPal business account, then we don't spend much time on them.
I mean, when we're acquiring users, we're obviously looking for the highest value we can get. And over 3/4 of our revenue is from in-app purchasing, which means most people are staying in our game for a long period of time. We have a very large community team at our studio that, you know, talks and engages with our players on a daily basis, whether it's through our support desk or through social media. We have hundreds of hours of video we record every year, from live streams to Twitch channels. Our team is actually up at the CAC Cafe today, doing the live stream on Facebook. So we really want to keep our community connected for as long as they can be. We have some players that have played since our game was launched, and that's, you know, years can be considered lifetimes on the mobile world. As far as users we don't want, we really don't want people that don't spend. So we're targeting primarily in tier A markets, and because of the style of our game, video views aren't as much of a monetization model for us. So a lot of markets like Brazil, for instance, they don't have a large credit card community there. They primarily watch video ads. So as much as we can acquire users for a lot cheaper there, it's not the focus of our activities.
I have to say, I love these. Like, your social team is on point. Like, I love their Instagram, and I'm really envious of all your lunches.
For us, we want users who are actually active on the platform and exploring content. You can pay for a PressReader subscription if you like, but we have a very interesting deity model where you can actually get it complimentary from our partners. So if you fly the airline, you're staying at almost any hotel, we're going on a cruise, you actually get it complimentary. So for us, it's important to have people actually have some new content to kind of discover different applications and actually explore our different categories. That's important to us. When it comes down to our social media and targeting, we want to make sure we are targeting people who are actually interested in that content. So when it comes to people we don't want, we want people who are interested in that. But basically for us, it's not so much the spend as much as it's going to be active actually.
And for us, it's been a big evolution at Hootsuite over the years. When Hootsuite launched, it really was like a Twitter client, a little bit of advanced Twitter client. There was a lot of Twitter clients out there. Twitter's APIs were really open. Everyone was building Twitter apps. And so we were kind of one of those, and we're getting tons of installs based off it. But over time, like, that was a little bit of a B2C model, but we're really a B2B company. And so over time, we've evolved a lot, and now we've like repositioned the app and the functionality of the product in general, the way it goes to market, and our user base is still a freemium model, so all the way from free to what we call self-serve, where people can upgrade and build teams on their own, all the way up to enterprise with customers like Starbucks and stuff like that, where their organizational complexity is very complex. They got teams and people need to get stuff approved before it can be posted on social. So one area that we definitely try to focus on that side, like the business side, the enterprise side, to the detriment of pure user acquisition. We could game the system a little bit and get a lot more app installs and maybe more signups, but those users are going to be, they're not going to enjoy the experience and won't be looking for that. So we've noticed that the way we communicate what our product is and then the user's experience when they actually launch it needs to be really, really well aligned, or we just get a bunch of users that never convert and they're not happy and it doesn't help anyone. So we spend a lot of time focusing more on retention in those business use cases.
All right, so Kevin, this one is for you.
I know that part of your time at Eastside Games is focused on ASO and SEO. I think ASO is still sort of like the black magic of knownness. I think there's a lot that we still don't understand about ASO, or SEO is a little bit more, you know, Google, there's like 5 billion things that you can look at that'll tell you what to do. But how important is SEO for mobile apps? And what are some of the ways that apps can use web search to improve acquisition? And are there any easy wins when it comes to ASO?
If you guys aren't aware, ASO is App Store Optimization. So it's basically the SEO for apps. Whether you search for a keyword, or you're searching for an emoji even inside of an app store, there's results that show up, and there's tons and tons of ways to try and optimize how your app appears in order to encourage organic installs. The most basic ones are icons, screenshots, your trailer, but also considering your app title, your short description and long description are very important. We use, on Google, there's a developer console has built-in experiments, which lets you tweak and adjust variations of your store listing. So, for instance, for Valentine's Day, we just had a new theme come out inside of our game. There was a lot of new workers, new artwork, and some features, as well as promotions that were around Valentine's Day. So we tried out using Valentine's Day themed graphics in our store, including a red icon, some different kind of Valentine's graphics, and changing some copy in our store description. Because this is built into Google, it's really easy to use. Apple doesn't have a similar tool. There are paid versions of things you can do out there, but we'll take the data we learned from Google and then we'll try and apply that to our Apple updates. And we find that that's giving us some pretty good results.
So you meant that users kind of in both stores, you can take that model and they behave similarly enough in the app store, the Apple app store, that you can apply that knowledge.
Yeah, a lot of similarities are there because people will search for the same sorts of terms. Where you see a lot of the differences is the way that people browse these stores. The categories, the way that things are organized, and the way things are featured are very, very different. On Google, you'll find a much more customized experience. It's based off of apps you've downloaded in the past, perhaps what your friends have. Depending on what you've rated things, different apps will be shown, and you'll actually have custom categories defined by you. Whereas on Apple, they kind of hand pick and choose a lot of their features. You'll sometimes see an editor's pick with a little footnote from an editor, and those don't just happen overnight. Those are planned weeks, sometimes months in advance, and a lot of times they're around different seasonal things, so Christmas or 420, things like that. They may actually do certain featurings around. So there's a secret code that no one really knows as to how to get your app in the top of the charts, but it's a battle that we're fighting every day.
I think it's called you have to convince someone. Okay, Lars, this one's for you. So Hootsuite just launched Enhance, I think in the end of 2016, which is a photo editing app, right? And so when you guys launched that, did you mainly target your existing user base, or what were some of the tactics that you took for growth around that app?
Yeah, so Enhance, simple photo editing app, very focused on optimizing your photo to share on social. So things like recommended crop sizes, if it's going to Twitter or Facebook, gives you a good crop size that's going to appear properly and not get cropped if it's on the social network. Compressing the file size a little bit, adding things like stickers and text and accompanying watermark, so that type of functionality. So first of all, premise, total experiment for us. It was kind of an opportunistic situation where we could try something like this. We have, like, the Hootsuite main app is a top-rated app in the App Store. We get a lot of volume from that, lots of installs and signups. And so our thesis was, what if we have another app that is top-rated in the App Store? Is that going to drive a lot of volume back to the business? Through Enhance, there's no ads. It's a free app, no in-app subscriptions. You don't even have to sign up to Hootsuite to use it. So our goal is to get, really, like, a lot of traffic there and then help drive that traffic back to Hootsuite. The only kind of value prop or conversion point we have is on the last screen where it says, you want to share? Tap here for Facebook, Twitter, and all these things, and then a little value prop. You want to share this later, or you want to share this to multiple networks at the same time, you can use Hootsuite for that. So what we did to launch that was definitely talk to the folks at Apple and try to get some love from them, and as a Canadian company, get a little bit of love, because they're always trying to boost up the Canadian apps, like Made in Canada section and stuff like that is well suited for the likes of our types of groups. And then a campaign to our existing clients. So through our web product, definitely mentioning it there, emailed existing clients, emailed clients that had recently signed up on iOS, And then one of the biggest movers was integrating it with our main app. So we know that our users wanted photo editing capabilities. Our main app doesn't have any. So users would have to bail out, use a different app, something like that. But what we did was when they've got the compose box open and they've attached the image, we put, like, very similar to Instagram, that little sort of icon there that says enhance, and enhance is good enough, so or like an adjective, so a good enough word for them to action on. Tap on that, gives them a value prop, deep links them right into the app, right, skips a couple screens, goes right into the editing flow as soon as they're done, kicks them right back into Hootsuite, so it's a really seamless flow. And that really helped. Like, we're driving a ton of our users there. And now, so it launched November 1st. It's been out a few months. And it's driving quite a few new users, not as much as we'd like. We're still trying to climb the rankings a bit, get more installs from it. But our existing users are using it a lot. They're using it really consistently, thankfully, somewhat. Like, not many users have complained about it being a separate app. That was a big thing that we talked about a lot. Why don't we build this into the main app? And the reason was a lot of reasons, but one, our main team is working on other stuff, and it's priorities. Our enterprise users aren't necessarily asking for a free photo editing app, but it's something that we knew our users would like. And so with proper analytics in place, we can see how it's affecting retention. Users that have both apps have higher retention, of course, a little correlation more than causation probably, but the repeat usage is a good indicator for us so far. So we actually, on a shameless plug, we submitted a new version today. Probably launch it later this week if it gets approved quickly. And just trying to make that better and better. Hopefully it can get to a nice place in the App Store where it's actually funneling a ton of traffic back to the main app and kind of rises both of those products.
It is a pretty cool tool. I downloaded it once when I'm looking up to figure out some questions to ask these guys, and I was like, oh, they have this photo editing tool now. And I actually quite liked it, so kudos to you guys. Good job.
Very much.
Right. We're going to come all the way back down to the end of the table, back over to Catherine. So you are a B2B app, and I think there's some specific KPIs that B2B looks at as opposed to a B2C app. So what are some of those KPIs, and do you focus more on like retention, engagement, is sharing important at all?
Well, fundamentally, because we are B2B, our number one core golden KPI that we look at is revenue. And if any of you are here thinking about starting a business, you're in startup mode, you're thinking about a B2B idea, the sooner that you accept that revenue is going to be your true north, the more successful you'll be. So, you know, obviously, you know, we're also a SaaS app. We're a SaaS business, so monthly recurring revenue is absolutely crucial for us. As I mentioned, you know, we're relatively young.